Hi guys, and welcome to episode 4 of West End Talks. We're going back to Tina the Musical, and as you remember, we've had Matt Mills before, who is in the cast of Tina. But this time we're going to Alex Okoampa. He is Ronnie in Tina the Musical. It's his West End debut, and he was also on Stage Swing in Motown the Musical UK tour. So we'll find out about all of that and more shortly in the coming time. But let's welcome Alex.
Hello.
Hi, welcome. Thanks for joining us, Alex.
Thank you for having me. How are you?
No, thank you. Thank you for joining us. It's a great privilege. It'll be good to get to know you a bit better rather than just the parts you've played.
You will,
So we'll get started. We'll start with the start for two. As the West End fans will know, West End Talks fans will know, it's the same questions. Pretty straightforward. The easiest questions you'll get probably tonight. And the first one is, what got you into performing?
Do you know what? It's so weird because I don't like questions like that. Because there's so many things that happen in your life from childhood and growing up as well that are contributing factors to what you want to do. Mm-hmm. I think, to be fair, I've always been quite a creative person, whether that be acting, singing, dancing, writing scripts, or just being outdoors and being creative. But I think my earliest memory of getting me into this was I was part of a youth club back in the day when I was younger, and they did a pantomime of Aladdin, and I joined that. I absolutely loved it. It was so funny. It was just such a lovely creative outlet and just such a lovely environment to be a part of, like to be a part of a cast and for people to come and watch you do what you can do. So I think that's my earliest memory of what kind of got me into musical theatre. But apart from just musical theatre, like I've done TV stuff, commercials, short films and stuff. So I kind of see it as like a whole umbrella. You know, don't limit yourself because there's so much more that you can do.
That's a great answer. That was a good answer. It's quite a hard question, as I say, because as you said there, sorry, because there is so much that happens throughout your life that does impact things. So yeah, I can understand that. So you talked about pantomime, but what was your first role?
The first role was... This was a month after I finished school. No, I'm sure it was about 3 weeks. I did a show called Babes in Arms, it's a classic. The older generation will know it. And I was casted as one of the De Quincey brothers. So I was Ivor De Quincey, which was massively nerve-wracking because I learned how to tap dance in school, as in training. And I only learned for 2 years. So the fact I got casted as a character where it was tap dance heavy and I was very exposed to it was mad. But I got the job for a reason, you know, and I absolutely loved it. It was such a lovely show to do. And the cast were lovely. And I'm still in touch with quite a few of them now. And I still see them, you know, out and about in the industry and stuff. So, yeah, that was the first role I did. Ivor De Quincey in Babes in Arms.
I don't like your older generation statement, by the way. I'm only 29 and I knew what it was.
Yeah, so but you're a musical theatre nerd. That's why.
I'll give you that one. Okay, I'll allow you that one. I'm like, excuse me, I'm 29. I'm not the older generation yet. Anyway, we'll move on and we will hold no responsibility for the next set of questions.
That's fine.
And they come from all either your fans or fans of the shows that you have been in. Now, the first one actually doesn't touch on musical theatre. And the first question comes from Alex. So I don't know if you've sent one in for yourself, but I doubt it.
That'll be weird if I did.
It was a different Alex. And he asks, when's your album coming out? Because he can't wait to hear your music.
Tell him to get in contact with me in 10 years' time.
It's
not
10 years, surely.
No, what it is, I don't know. Okay, I started off minorly successfully doing music around 2016, 2017.
You've been played in Radio 1, have you not?
Yeah. So I was played on Radio 1. I submitted my song to them and they played it all week. But to me, it was a hobby back then. So I just kind of made music as a creative outlet, you know, to have fun, just to mess around. And then it kind of got a bit more serious, but I couldn't really dedicate myself to it fully because I trained in musical theatre and I wanted to make it there. You know, I'm one of those people where I can't, I'm rubbish at multitasking. Like, I can't even text and have a conversation. Don't do it. I can't.
You're a man.
Don't do it. So yeah, I put all my energy into musical theatre and I still am. It's only until this pandemic happened that I kind of rediscovered my love for it and like what I want to write about and what I want to produce and the kind of artist I want to be. So it's given me a lot of time to think about it, and I am in the process of, you know, writing an EP and producing an EP. I've got 3 songs ready. So yeah, we'll see what happens. It, for me, it's all about timing. Timing is everything for me.
Yeah, very true, yeah.
And timing and just, I'm not the kind of person to churn out something that I know isn't 100% to me.
No.
Mm-hmm. You know? And if I was to put something out now, I would be like, oh, this 1 minute, one mark, oh, I shouldn't have done that there, or I shouldn't have done this there, or I should have done an inflection here. Oh, I would have been a nightmare. But so yeah, I guess it's just time and making sure it's perfect to me, ready for me to put out. So yeah, it'll come soon, Alex. I promise it'll come soon. You hear something this year.
That's good to know. That's good to know. You do put music out there. You've got a YouTube page, have you not?
Yeah. Now my first music video came out in January 4th for you, which was mad. Yeah,
we'll share that, don't worry, we'll get that shared about. Next question comes from Jade. She's actually inputted a few questions.
Oh, is this Jade Marvin
from Sex?
Oh yeah.
Yes.
Oh
yes.
She stalks me. She's a stalker. Listen, no, we had a bet with her before I went in this, and I said, if you dare me to say you're a stalker, I would do it, and she dared me, so there we go.
Okay, that's fine. You've said that you've won the bet. I think Jade, fair and square, he's won the bet. But she has inputted a few questions, and we do ask everything that gets sent in. So she asks, firstly, any advice for people wanting to make it on the West End?
Yes. Believe in your source. Believe in what you can do. And don't watch other people and envy them or be jealous. Don't keep watching other people and think, I want what they have, because you can only offer as much as what you can offer. That comes with hard work, determination, and the passion and love of doing what it is you love to do, which is, you know, musical theatre, acting, whatever. Just make sure that the love for it is always going to be there, and make sure you're always going to work hard, and it will happen.
That's very good advice. That's, yeah, very, very good advice, I would say. Really good advice, actually. So everything will happen. Mia?
On for hours, honestly.
That's right, you're more than welcome. It's your episode. You can go on for as long as you like. Mia wants to know, have you learned anything new in lockdown? Something brand new?
Oh, is that like a general thing?
That you can answer. We don't assume questions. We just literally ask you as the fans send them in. You can answer that however you want.
Yeah, I'd say.
I would think she means general. I don't think she means musical theatre wise.
No, of course.
I don't think she would be that specific.
Have I learned something new? I think I've learned myself more. Purely because I've been on the go, I don't know, since 2013, which is when I started training and chasing a dream or chasing an ambition. You don't really have the time to stop and learn who you are, what you like, what you don't like, to think about how you are internally, how you are personally, how you are emotionally, mentally, physically. You don't have a moment to do that because everything's go, 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 go. If you stop, you feel like life is going on without you and there's a lot of missed opportunities. But even if there are missed opportunities, they will always come back around again, just as long as you put the effort in and you have patience, you practice patience. So for me, I think I've definitely learned more about who I am, you know, as I said, mentally, spiritually. I discovered that I actually like to read books, and I didn't know I did. I've always known, it's weird, like you don't really think to buy a book and read if you're not like a book enthusiast, because you're mainly on your phone the whole time, you know, or you're on your laptop and you're on watching a screen and you're reading, but you don't actually read words like you did once in school in English, you know. So I think that's something that that's new that I learned about this, is I like to read and just discovering who I am and my purpose in the world.
I've got to agree with you, actually. I've got a book beside my bed all the time. Literally, since the start of lockdown, I've had a different book. So I'm second there with you.
Good on you, honestly.
Yes. But no, I can understand that they're finding yourself. I think a lot of people have kind of had that experience in the last 4 months or however long it's been. It feels like it's been 5 years, never mind 4 months. but no, definitely, I think a lot of people find themselves and are doing things that they didn't expect to be doing this year, definitely. But that's good to know. Moving on, Ross wants to know, quite a good question. We get this one, we've had this one quite a few times. What's one piece of advice you would give to your 16-year-old self?
Love yourself. Love yourself.
That's some good advice.
If you don't love yourself, then who's going to love you?
That's a bit of a ripple there, but yes, very true.
Being you starts with knowing and loving yourself. And once you accept who you are, positive vibes start coming your way. All the things you set out to do in your life, or all the things you want to happen to you, will start happening, purely because no one can touch your bubble of energy, the energy that you've created, the energy and self-love that you have manifested by loving and learning yourself. And it's so often we as humans, I've brought this up before, envy, you know, other people, or I want this or I want that, I wish, you know, my nose was smaller, etc., etc., etc. But you are perfect exactly the way you are, and you often find yourself lost, and being lost can sometimes be such an indescribable thing that even try and describe, you can't describe it, because what are you lost in? Do you know what I'm saying? What are you lost in? So you need to find yourself, love yourself, and do what it is you want to do in life, you know. So yeah, that's what I'd say to my 16-year-old self, and it's taken me 9 years to kind of understand that. Me 2 years ago is not the same person I am speaking to you right now, and I'm so proud of myself. And I think you should always be proud of yourself and the journey that you've taken. So that's what I'd say to my 16-year-old self. Yeah, that was deep.
That was very deep, but it was very good to hear. It was some good advice. But I second everything you've said, definitely. Yes, anyway, moving on. We're moving on to some less random questions and more about shows that you've been in. We're going to start with this one here. Now, I know you haven't actually started in this show yet. It was supposed to be your opening night the day after the theatres went dark. Mm-hmm. So the theatres went dark on the 16th of March, and your opening night was supposed to be the 17th. Mm-hmm. But you'll get there. You'll have your opening night eventually.
Hopefully.
Oh, you will. It will happen at some point. Definitely at some point. But Amber wants to know, have you met the woman herself?
No, and oh, I bloody wish I did. No, I haven't met her, but I feel her energy. I feel her spirit with us. Because, like, when we do script reads or when we learn the harmonies to the song or learn the songs and do the choreography, her essence is there through and through. You can't dismiss it. You can't even try and put a bit of you in it, because this show was based on Tina Turner. The whole thing is Tina Turner. From the very beginning, she was there throughout the casting process, throughout the workshops, throughout writing the show. She was there from the beginning. She picked who she wanted. She picked the song she wanted in the show. She picked the routine. She's like, everything is her. So when I do meet her, I think I'll cry. But no, I haven't met her, but I feel like I have, spiritually.
Hopefully she'll come back over after lockdown's over for the relaunch of the West End.
Hopefully.
Come over and see it again. Just because.
Yeah, just why not?
Do you think she'd have to buy a ticket? That's what I'd love to know.
I mean, if she wants to support local business. No. Do you know what? Whatever she wants, she gets. This is her show.
Then she walks into the box office and says, This is actually named after me, so I get to just walk in.
Honestly.
Or does she, no, I'd like to buy a ticket, a day seat, if possible. Do you have any day seats available?
It'll all be done for her. Before she even lands it, it'll be done for her.
I don't think she'll be the one queuing up at 8 o'clock in the morning to get a day seat.
Oh, no.
I think I'd probably collapse if that happened, definitely.
Oh, my God, honestly. She's just a woman. I've watched so many interviews of her, obviously to prepare for the show, and I've watched when the show first came here, because it debuted.
Yeah.
So she was there the whole time, and I've seen videos and stuff, and I'm like, oh my God, I can't believe I'm part of this show that she did. Yeah, I mean, one day I'll meet her.
Sure, positive. Georgie wants to know, what's your favourite scene in Tina? So the musical, obviously, not Tina herself.
Oh God, I need to get my script. It's because I haven't been through it in a while.
Yeah.
Oh my God, I'm so sorry.
Somebody's popular.
It's my best friend. My favourite scene. Okay. I think my favourite scene is a musical number in the show, which is called Disco Inferno.
Right.
That number is so fast-paced. So intricate with the moves and groovy. It's so quick, you have no time to breathe. You're drenched in sweat, and we've got the sickest outfits ever. Like, it's flared arms, flared trousers, everything is snatched, everything is tight. And we're just running around on the stage with handheld microphones, running back and forth, jumping, split leaps, everything. It's so camp. And so sick, and that's my favorite scene. Like, I can't wait to do it. Every time we rehearse to do it, we're passed out on the floor. But I think what's so funny about that scene as well is every time in rehearsals, our choreographer Simone, amazing woman, phenomenal, she'd be like, okay, great. One more time. And we're like, Simone, no.
Really?
But when we do it, it's just so feel good. And she wants it to be perfect. She'll get it perfect. And we'll make sure it's perfect. So that's my favourite scene. It's just such a feel-good number.
Yeah, I think having seen that as an audience member, I'm out of breath sitting down watching you, never mind doing the actual routine. It's certainly, yes. I've seen it. I've seen the musical a few times, and it's definitely, you're as an audience member going...
Literally.
Just watching you.
Honestly, but with this cast, we have a lot of changes implemented from Broadway.
Right.
So, I mean, if you have a good enough memory to remember, you know, the first two casts and you watch R1, you would notice a lot of differences. And everything is just so much more smoother, so much more cleaner. And yeah, I can't wait for you to watch it. I'd love to hear your opinion on it as well. But yeah, when we're ready to go, come and watch.
Oh, 100%, I will be there. I'm going to every theatre just one night after another. I'm going to take about 2 weeks off work and just go, right, I'll go to start at the Auschwitz and then move on and finish up at the Phoenix or the Dominion or wherever we go. I don't know how you can do that in a circle, but we'll figure it out. If your mum, if you're watching, I'm joking. I'm not taking 2 weeks off to go to theatre. I'm joking. Moving on, Liam wants to know, similar to the last question, but what he wants to know, what your favourite song is in Tina. Could be the same answer, it might be different.
Song in Tina. Oh, I have too many. I think. Oh, I don't know. Do you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to go through the score. I'm going to go through the musical
album. I'm going to get the playlist up. Get the Spotify playlist.
Yeah, and honestly, I need to because it changes all the time. We have, okay, so post-opening number, so the opening number is called Knuckle City Limits, but there's a post-scene and a post kind of song that happens in it where we hum and we ooh and it's very ethereal. One of the changes in this year's cast is I was selected and another female cast member in that scene to riff and to do a lot of riffing and a lot of soulful like singing in the scene. And oh my God, if you hear it, it's just like our souls are pouring out of us and it's just so sick. Like it's just such, oh, I'm so irritated that we closed and no one got to see it, but everyone will one day. That's one of my favorite numbers. And I think my favorite full number, I'd say, has to be, oh, We Don't Need Another Hero.
Oh, that's a nice one, yes.
And I'd say that because it's so solemn, it's so still, it's so powerful. When we come in the auditorium, through the aisles with our candles, not only are we walking in, but our voices hit you like a brick wall. And I remember watching it for the first time and I cried because I thought, oh my God, this is so beautiful. It's just such a beautiful scene, beautiful lyrics, so well orchestrated. And it kind of is a sense of togetherness because the whole cast are there on stage together, singing and supporting Tina through her mum's death. And it's kind of like giving Tina the strength to sing Simply the Best, which is the next number straight away, you know? And everything, from the top of the show right into that moment kind of culminates there. It ends there. And that's when Simply the Best happens. And it's like, oh my God, I can't believe, like, oh yeah, that's my favorite number. That's, yeah.
Yeah, I've got to agree. Yeah, it's a nice number, especially when you all start coming through with the candles. It's like, oh, because you don't expect as an audience member, because you don't expect these to come through the audience very often. Like, I know the Lion King does and stuff. There is some famous scenes, but if you don't know much of it, you know, the musical, and you hadn't seen it before, you don't expect it. It's nice.
Mm-mm.
It's nice.
So lovely, honestly.
So Taylor wants to know, why do you think Tina's story has become something that is needed and it's still watched by sellout audiences?
Because, oh, there's so many different factors. I will start off with her story, being a black woman back in the day, you know, in the 1900s. I say 1900s, I'm on about like 19. Listen, I'm not even going to go over date because I know people will insult me. So back when she was
1960s and 70s.
Yes, there we go. She was around the Motown era, actually. She had a tough upbringing. And when you do watch the show, or if you do know about her story, you know, you witness a lot of physical abuse, mental abuse, substance abuse. And she just had it rough, man. And a lot of people identify with it still, because people are still being abused. People are still, you know, suffering from substance abuse, mental abuse from partners. And I guess she's testament that you can make it through all the hardship and all the negativity and what life throws at you. You will, and you can make it through. And I guess her escape was her love for singing, was her love for performing. And it's so amazing that she was an icon back then and she's still an icon now. No one can do it like Tina. Even the current, you know, the current big stars still look up to Tina. Beyonce looks up to Tina. She's inspired by her. I mean, even me saying her name, Tina, it's like, oof, okay. You feel like a force because that is the that is what she built herself to be. But even at the tender age of 80, she's still the same humble, cracking, phenomenal woman that she was, that she grew up to be. And yeah.
Forever. No, that's very true. And it's still at 80, she's still performing the same way she was at 20.
Exactly. I mean,
like, what you watch her and you think, she's never 80. Like, she's only 20. You know, they're looking up to her. There's not many people out there that can, you can say the first name and you know exactly who they're talking about. Like, you say Tina and there's no other, like, that's not a bad thing to other Tinas, but there's no, you automatically think Tina Turner. Like, not many people can go by just the first name. That's what I was getting at. There's not many people out there, like, Beyonce's about the only one I can think of, obviously, that, because she's known as Beyonce.
Yeah.
But, Tina Turner. It's just, yeah, I think the word's thrown about a lot, but with Tina, legend is definitely one of them. It's thrown about a lot, but it's definitely not for Tina. That's without a doubt. But anyway, Ellie wants to know, why do you think Tina the Musical, you've mentioned this actually, why do you think Tina the Musical got its debut in the UK?
Because Tina's music was so successful internationally, and she came to London to write one of her albums. What's Love Got to Do with It was written in the UK. It wasn't how the song was released. She didn't like it. But they changed it up and made it work for her. And she blew up in the UK and then internationally. She was, in my opinion, I think she was much more appreciated internationally than she was in America. But that success kind of trickled back to her home. And she created a legendary status here. So I think she wanted to give something back to the place that gave her a chance. And you have to remember, she was in her 40s when she made it big here.
Yeah.
I don't know of any artist that can make it big in this current climate around 40 years old, you know? And as we said before, she's doing better than most of them right now. Still, you know, they can't do it like her. So I think that's why they premiered it here. And I'm so glad that they did. So glad, because it kind of gives us a sense of ownership in a good way, in a positive way, that it's like, this is ours. Tina Turner, the musical, started here. And it's still going strong. It's opened in 5 different countries.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, it's nice to see a big musical like that get its West End debut, a debut in the West End is what I mean. Because obviously a lot of musicals, like, and I'm not disrespecting any musical here, but Dear Evan Hansen, Be More Chill, all those kind of musicals had obviously debuts in the US and had to wait to come over. Whereas this one, it was the opposite. It was a massive musical, massive opening, and Broadway had to wait.
Exactly. You
know, there's not many musicals that have done that, where they've opened in the UK before. So that's especially this side of like this side of 2000. There's certainly not many musicals, definitely.
The only other musical that opened here and now is in America.
Certainly in the recent times, anyway. Yeah, definitely. Obviously, there's been other ones like Les Mis and stuff. I've you know, debuted a bit. And then went to, but we're talking like 2000s, there's not many. I think that is literally the only two. Correct me if I'm wrong in the comments, please. Correct me if I'm wrong. I'm sure I am. Anyway, moving on. You were in the tour of Motown, the musical.
Yes.
So the first question is about the position you had in the cast. And Andrew says, silly question, this is his words, silly question, but can you explain what it means by on stage swing?
Okay. So, on stage swing is, we are part of the cast that perform every night, but we have minor roles in the show. So we're pretty much there to fill up the ensemble numbers or extra numbers where extra bodies are needed. But we also had like our own specific things that we had to do in the show to keep the show running. So for example, I'll get into that in a second. So that's the first part of being on stage swing. The second part is we are the people that will cover every other ensemble character in the show, the males. So apart from knowing our own track, we knew all other nine of the boys in the show and the ensemble number. So during rehearsals, you know, we're learning our own track and learning theirs and their positions and their harmonies and everything at the same time. Yeah, it's mad. So yeah, we were made very easily cuttable in the show. So we either, so when we're cut, another swing, off stage swing, doesn't have to come and fit in our positions. The show will carry on as normal with minor change to staging, but we would essentially replace the ensemble member that's injured or off sick and do that until they come back. So it's very thrilling, I'll say that. It's such a thrilling experience. So that's what I'm saying.
It must be hard work, like to learn 10 tracks. Obviously tracks, for anybody at home that doesn't know tracks, we have spoke about it in previous episodes, but just in case, there's something new maybe. Tracks, obviously we're not talking about the songs, we're talking tracks are the characters, the parts, but the roles, if you like, aren't they? It's just a musical theatre term. That describes how many characters, how many parts they know. One character, so like Tina and Tina the Musical would be one track. Ike could be another track, things like that. So that it's how many Alex knew, and Alex, 10 is a massive amount to learn.
Honestly, I don't know how I did it because I didn't exactly know what an on-stage swing was. I didn't know what I was in store. I didn't know what was in store for me until I got to rehearsals. Yeah, to be fair, I advise any performer to be a swing one because it broadens your skills and it makes you realize that you're more capable than doing what you think you can do. I didn't think I could learn everybody's choreo, everybody's staging positions, numbers, harmonies, where I'm going to get my wig, where I'm going to get my costume. Everyone is different and I'm so glad that I powered through it and did it in 16 months. It was such a massive learning curve. Wow, what an experience.
I can imagine, yes. I'm not a performer, but I can imagine like how I can see how hard one track is. So to learn one track, it is hard enough, but like I've got so much appreciation for swings. Like, because they're sometimes overlooked wrongly, but they're sometimes overlooked swings. And that's why when we set off with our West End Talks awards, the first two awards that I wanted to do were understudy and swing, because they're two that are majorly overlooked in a lot of award shows and stuff, because as much as okay swings might never ever be on, the chances of that are slim, but there is a chance that they might never be on stage. But they're vital parts of the show, because without them, the show couldn't go on, because if anything was to happen, then they'd have to just cancel the whole show.
Exactly. Swing so, honestly, definitely. So massively. Swings are massively underrated. and understudies, they saved the show. And you can't tell me that anybody who is casted as a swing or understudy who knows so many tracks at the same time, they can't tell me they're not superhuman. They cannot tell me they're not superhuman. And it's so rubbish that in this industry, they are kind of overlooked. And it's sad, even by cast members, they are overlooked. And at times I felt like I wasn't really part of the cast, purely because of my position, but I quickly overcame that. And you just realize that you're just as important as the next person who got casted.
100%, yeah, 100%. Definitely, I think it's, I completely agree with that. I get quite excited when I see there's understudies or swings on if I go in. This going in for somebody in particular, I don't like. Mm-hmm. I go in for the show, not to see. I might go because I've heard of somebody's really good or that. That's different. Going on recommendation is different to going to see a celebrity or a big name. I don't do that. I go to see the show. Mm-hmm. I don't care who's in it. I don't. And when I see there's a swing, oh great swing! I get to see them work. Mm-hmm. Actually, work for their money rather than just sit backstage. Exactly. I get to do what they want to do rather than sit backstage and play whatever, do whatever, read the script or whatever you do when you're not on stage.
Not too much.
Get to relax.
Yeah.
Ready to go if needed.
A bit too much relaxing. I mean, it gives you the opportunity to catch up on, I don't know, TV or just, I don't know. I know some people who are swings, when they weren't on, they were studying to be a PT or building like a brand for vegan food and such. So the time is there to be utilized, but you always have to be mentally ready and within earshot of being called on stage last minute. So yeah, it's really strange. It's 50-50. Some people like the relaxation part of it, but if you're anything like me, I want to be on.
Yeah, I like to do stuff. I don't like to sit back.
Exactly.
Yeah, I hate this lockdown has been torture for a lot of us, but for me personally, because I hate sitting about doing nothing. Even in the house, I could do stuff in the house, so I don't like have to be out and about all the time, but I need to be doing something constantly. That's why this came up. Definitely. So, but moving on, Noor, apologies for the pronunciation of your name if it's incorrect. I do apologise. Where were you a fan of Motown before the show? Like Motown music?
Of music? I thought you meant the show.
No, Motown music.
Well, my dad has a lot of, let me see if I can show you. He has a lot of, records. He has a record player and he has a lot of music and a lot of records here. So
wow.
See, he has like a massive collection of CDs and stuff, Elvis. I'm sure there's Motown stuff in here, but he'd always kind of
tapes.
Yeah. Cassette tapes.
Oh, that takes me back.
What is this one? This one says Rick Astley.
Wow. That's not Motown. That's no Motown.
That's not Motown. But yeah, there's loads of stuff here. Billy Ocean. But he always used to play a lot of like Motown music or just music in general every Sunday. So I knew of them. Here we go. That's Jackson 5 over there. I can see. So yeah, he has a massive collection.
See that? Yeah.
He used to play a lot of Motown music as well. So I knew of the songs. But I never really thought I'd be in a show that champion these songs and it's part of a musical. I didn't think it'd work, but when I went to watch it for the first time on the West End, a good couple of years before I even got casted in the tour, I was amazed. It was like, oh my god, this is so feel good. Like, it's just all about the music. It's all about the music. So yeah, I was a fan.
It's got a small part to the story. I think there's a small kind of lean on in the story, because obviously that it's similar story to Tina, but not dramatic, not the same. It's a kind of fight of colour. It's being the colour and trying to make it in the music industry. Mm-hmm. I think rather than there's no domestic violence or much, I can't remember there was none of that or drug use or anything like that. It was more the being black and struggling to make it in the US music industry. So that's where Motown obviously came from, and it came from Berry Gordy couldn't make it, so he created Motown basically. Mm. And the majority of acts are acts of colour. Black actors, singers and songwriters. We do. There's some white, isn't there? There's some white.
Yeah. In Motown,
majority of them are.
Yeah, the majority are black or mixed race.
Yeah.
In Motown, we usually have two white males, and then a white swing who is usually the resident director at the same time. So yeah. In most black shows, there are always white performers in the show as well, because you can't tell the story without telling the story, and you can't hide behind things that happen. And most of that, some of it weren't even bad, you know. Some of it was good. Like white people were allies back in the day, as well as targeting us for negativity and racism and stuff. So yeah.
No, it's quite an app, even especially at the moment, it's quite an app story. Definitely at the moment, at all times, I'm not just saying at the moment obviously, but especially at the moment with the Black Lives Matter movement and stuff, it's a story that's very much needed. It's a musical that's about that, it's like that. And I was talking to Michael Vinson from Hairspray, he's going to Hairspray, and that's another story that's, I think, very much needed at the moment, and just to, as I say, it's needed all the time, but especially at the moment, just to knock some sense into a lot of people, and knock some whatever into them. Anyway, we're not too political, that's not the point in the chat. As much as it's your platform, you're more than welcome, but it's not
I'm
the
good.
Point.
I'm good.
Russell wants to know, what's your favourite song in the musical?
Again,
you know, do. Again, get the playlist out.
The playlist out, because I don't.
See, me, it's about, you kind of beat about Jackson 5 for me.
Jackson,
I like Stevie Wonder. Stevie Wonder, Jackson 5.
Do you know what? The Jackson 5, the only thing I can think of are the numbers, the choreography that we did, and how wrong I got it. Because in rehearsals, those were the kind of last numbers we learned. And oh my god, the amount of choreography that we didn't show was a headache. So I just could not get it. Most things were canon. Oh, I just couldn't get it. But my favorite song in the show was My Girl. No, Dancing in the Street. No, Mike. Both. No.
You're acting on yourself here, Alex. You know that?
Pardon?
You're arguing with yourself here.
I am. I do it all the time.
Okay, that's fine, as long as you know.
Oh, 100%. Talk to yourself all the time, honestly. Dancing in the Street. I absolutely love that number. It's just so feel good. I play the original all the time in the kitchen when I'm cooking. And, it's just such a feel-good number. And when we did it on stage, we had the best times, the funniest times ever. Like, let me tell you one quick story.
That's fine.
So in our mock-up matinee, which is what happened, a mock-up matinee is a show where I think a day before the final show, we have a little play around, but it's amongst our cast, and as long as it's not detrimental to the show, it's okay. And the audience wouldn't really notice. Most shows don't do it. Some shows do. But one time, one of our show members was dressed as a granny in the number just before Dancing in the Streets. And she didn't do her quick change to rejoin the number as one of the girls who dance in the street. So she was in her granny outfit throughout the whole thing. And we were just crying It was so hard to sing into the routine because there's an old granny dancing with us on the street and we're like, what the hell is going on? It was just the best, the funniest thing ever. But apart from that, my other favourite song is My Girl. That song got amazing reception every night. It's like the number everybody waits for in the show. As soon as you hear dun 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 dun, everyone's like, it's just such a smooth number, so well written, so intricate, so soft, so smooth, so sexy. And it just made me feel like a boss every time I did that number. And just hearing the original ensemble boys do it, oh, it just, it's like chocolate. It melts my heart, man, honestly. But yeah, those are my two favourite songs in the musical, I think.
Yeah, no, quite two. Better Jackson 5, you kind of beat them. But what was the song? I'm terrible with names of songs. The song was written for the musical. There was an original number in it.
Yes.
Something about closing doors or something, was it not?
Yeah, Can I Close the Door?
Can I Close the Door? Obviously written by Barry Gordy, wasn't it?
Not Barry Gordy. It was, I forgot the writer.
It was written for her. Like he asked for it to be commissioned.
Yeah. In the show. So, Can I Close the Door in Love?
I think that one's fantastic as well, especially as you're not expecting an original song. Because mm-hmm. The first time I thought, I'm sitting there, and obviously I knew all the songs, and then this one started, and I'm like, I don't know this one. I'm like, right, okay, who sings this one? And then looks up, obviously, after the show, and you go, oh, it's an original. All right, okay, good. Because it's obviously...
You know,
what's that?
But you forget, like, it's a musical, so you kind of have to add that kind of theatrical aspect to it. And I think it drew the whole show together.
100%, yeah.
You know, to a close. Can I Close the Door? Beautiful song. So, just a great song. I'm going to go into
We're now getting a tour of Alex's room. Hey, Alex's house.
My brother's room. Yeah, hello to my house. It's my crib, MTV. No, I'm in my brother's room now because my parents have just come through the door. I'm shopping. So, Can I Close the Door in Love? Gorgeous song, man. So well written. Such a powerful song as well.
Yeah, no, definitely it is. Ashley wants to know, do you have a favourite Motown song that's not in the musical?
Yes. I say this to my friends all the time. It's Spider Supremes. I've forgotten it.
I'm terrible with names of songs, so I can't help you. The only Supreme song that I know is Baby Love.
But that's in the show. Keep me holding on. There you go.
There we go.
Keep me hanging on. That song gets me going. It's such a sassy, fun song. And I was so like annoyed that it wasn't in the musical, because those girls would have slayed it, honestly. And it's just such a feel-good number. I play it all the time as well. That's one song I wish was in the show. Maybe if it comes back around, it will be. Who knows?
The thing is, because obviously Barry Gordy did have a hand in writing the show. Mm-hmm. He had a hand in, and whoever the creators, I wouldn't have wanted to be the creator of this show, because there's so many songs from the Motown era. It's not an era, it's a record label. That's what people forget. It's not actually an era, it's an actual record label. There's so many, whether it's an era or a record label, so many fantastic songs that I would not want to be the one that picks the songs for the musical, because you'll never please everybody. Mm-hmm. Like, you'll have put in a song that somebody doesn't want in, that people don't want in, and you'll have missed out songs that people want, and there would be no happy medium. You'd never please everybody. Mm-hmm. So that's it. It's a tough job. I think they've done a fantastic job with the musical, don't get me wrong. Mm-hmm. I loved every song that was in it, but there was a lot of songs, obviously, that don't think there was any Lionel Richie, was there?
No,
there was no Lionel Richie. There was no... I'm going to make a fool of myself, so I'm not saying anymore.
I don't blame you.
Aye, I'll say no more before I make a fool myself. But anyway, moving on, Daniel wants to know, who's your number one Motown legend? So not musical-wise, the actual record label.
I don't want to upset people.
I really don't think they're going to be watching. I'd love to say that all the Motown legends are going to watch this, but I don't really think they are.
Look, okay, I've got two.
Right, do that thing. What texture?
The Supremes for me were up there. They don't make them like the Supremes no more.
No.
They had it, even through the drama and the constant lineup changes, like the Sugar Babes. They just had it. Like, their songs were amazing. The styling was amazing. Even though it was mainly focused on Diana until she went solo. Their songs are just classics. You hear it and you're like, this is the Supremes. Yep. Apart from them, Marvin Gaye was a big icon in the Motown era, and his writing is still applicable to today.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Things he spoke about in songs in the past are still happening today, especially What's Going On, which is the closer to Act One of Motown. What he sings about being worn, like, you know, being for brothers and sisters and people dying and stuff, it's still happening today, which is so scary. He left a legacy that will keep on going on until the end of time, I hope. So yeah, both Supremes.
I hope the story's changed, though. I hope the legacy will always be there of Marvin Gaye, but I think, I hope the stories and his songs change eventually and people get it into their thick skull. That's all I'll say in that matter. Yes. Moving on, Carol says, touching a bit actually on what we said, why do you think the Motown story is still needed? So I need to ask because it's a question that's put in, but you've kind of covered that already, really.
As in the musical? Or?
As in the musical, yes. No, as in the musical, sorry, yes. Motown, the musical story.
Because to me, it's the godfather of music. No, it's a lot of music is based from around that era. And when you think about it, songs these days are heavily influenced by Motown music.
Yeah.
I know there's an artist called Tom Misch. He's inspired by like the riffs and the grooviness from that era because it's unmatched. You can't touch it. Their grooves, they had so much fun that a lot of artists and stuff are missing at the minute. It was just so carefree, as I said before. Everything was fun. Everyone just wanted to have fun. And people need that in their lives. I think in this generation, we're so artists or people like us, we're so caught up in, oh, are they number one? Or, oh, what have they done apart from the music that kind of builds their brand? Like, have they got a fashion brand or this and that? Or there's so many different aspects and we get lost that the music isn't the main focus anymore. Mm-hmm. Having fun isn't the main focus anymore. People churn out albums because they're on a contract, not just because they want to make the music that they want to make. Like Ellie Goulding, her first album was amazing because that came from her. Her last album, which she just released last week, Brightest Blue, that is the sound that she wants to make now. Whereas the past couple of albums was a bit kind of, in fact, the last album, Delirium, was very overproduced. Yikes. And it didn't feel like her. It felt like she was missing from the record.
Mm.
So people need this story to kind of remind them of what music is and how music should make you feel, what it should do to you, and so on.
That's fantastic advice, definitely. And some good, I think we make it clear the Scenario SN Talks holds no responsibility for Alex's opinions on Ellie Goulding's albums. I think it all has a bit, no, I'm joking. I don't think she'll watch, so it's fine.
Love you, Ellie.
I don't think she'll be watching. I'd love her to, again, a bit like the Motown Legends. I'd love her to watch, but I don't think she will. Ellis wants to know, so we're kind of finished with the Motown questions. We're back to a bit of the random questions. Ellis wants to know, what's your favourite sandwich filling? We ask all questions that we get in, I'll be honest.
Ham, cheese and cucumber.
Ooh.
Keep it simple.
Yeah. Be that mayonnaise or sour cream? No, just
sometimes it can get a bit messy.
I'm not getting into that. I'll not say any of the same thing, but it's a family-friendly show. Anyway, Lee, moving on. Lee says, if you had to be... I love this question. We get this question a lot. If you had to be in lockdown with one character from Tina the Musical... So we're going for characters here, not who plays them. So character from Tina the Musical, who would it be and why?
Oh, that's difficult.
See, I love that question. We get that one a lot. I think most interviews, actually, we've got that in for people.
I'd love to be... Okay. With... There's a character in a show called Tony. And she is a choreographer that was brought in to choreograph one of Tina's shows. And Tina did not like her routines or anything on that day. She was like, this is not me. Tony was so flamboyant. She's a flamboyant character. She comes on stage. And she kind of gives Tina an example of what of the choreography that she's set. And it's so camp, it's so funny. She's like, ha, ha, ha. And it's just, she's the funniest character in the show, hands down. I'd love to be stuck with her because she's so positive, she's infectious, she's corny, she's a goof, and I love it. I love people like that.
In lockdown, that not get a bit annoying. Yeah, I think everybody would get a bit annoying in lockdown, to be honest. No matter who you are. Yeah, I think we've all learned, I'm in a house share and I love it to bits, but we've all learned of each other and things, so it's been interesting.
Cool. Yeah.
To say the least. I'm so glad I wasn't with family. Like, I love my family to bits, and they will be watching because they watch all my videos, but I love them to bits, but I am so glad I wasn't locked down with them because I may be in prison by now. Anyway, Grace wants to know, what's your favourite restaurant chain?
Vapiano's.
Where? Yeah.
Vapiano's. Have you never heard of Vapiano's?
Never heard of it. Wow. So, no.
Oh, you're missing out. I think they went into administration recently. But they're a pasta food chain. It's an Italian food chain.
Right. I love Italian food, so that's hanging up.
But this Italian food is good. And it's cheap as well. They make the food in front of you. You pick the pasta. You say this and that, and they make it right in front of you. And it's just such a nice interior decor. It's a chill vibe. Their plates are sick. They're so nice. It's just a good vibe, and it's cheap as well. It's a really good chain. I don't know if they're going to be running after this pandemic, but hopefully they do. And hopefully you get to experience it, because their carbonara is amazing. Amazing.
I like how you had to move. It's amazing.
Their garlic bread too. Oh my. Yeah.
I will check it out then once lockdown's completely over. I'll check it out and see how it goes. Two more questions, and they both come from Jade, your friend or your stalker.
Yeah.
The first one is, she wants to know, is how do you stay so resilient?
Repeat that, please.
How do you stay so resilient?
Oh, she's so funny. Oh, that's a difficult thing. Oh, I don't know. I think just knowing your worth, just knowing what you're... I don't know. Okay. Let me think about it. Give me 2 seconds.
No bother. I'll give you some time.
Knowing that you deserve more. Okay. And not stopping until you get what you want. But that isn't a competition of other people. It's a competition of myself.
Makes sense.
How?
Makes sense. And last question, again from Jade. She says, how have you kept your drive going after knockbacks? It's quite a good one.
It is a good one. Okay, So I've had a gazillion and one auditions in my career so far. And with every knockback, I work to kind of fix what it is that they thought I lacked in. Mainly back in 2016-17, that was with dance. You know, I'm not a dancer, I'm a very strong mover. Teach me routine and I'll do it. But I will never give you, I don't know, I couldn't stand, I couldn't do ballet on point. Like, sorry, I can't do that. Do you know what I mean? I forgot the question.
Hey, how have you kept your drive going?
There we go. Yeah. So I like to prove people wrong. If they say I can't do it, I want to come back next time and show you I can do it. Mm-hmm. And that's what life should be about. Just because someone says I can't do something, it doesn't mean I'm going to accept what they think I can't do. So I just go and do it. And luckily it's worked out for me. It's all about skills. Learn new skills. Work on yourself. Progress. Because Rome wasn't built in a day.
That's very true.
So I'm building my own Rome at the minute.
And you're getting there. Definitely. I did see you in the tour of Motown. Can't remember exactly where, because I saw it in three different locations. At different times. So I can't remember exactly which cast I saw where, but I did see you. Definitely. But moving on, that's you finished the fans' questions, you'll be glad to know. So you can relax slightly. All that's left just now is the not so quick fire round. It used to be called quick fire round, but you're about to find out why we had to change its name. So the first question in this round is, we ask the same questions to everybody, and the first question is, what would be your dream role? So that's if somebody says you could have any role you wanted, regardless of age or race, not gender, because we'll come to that in a minute. So male parts, any male part.
Marius and Les Mis.
Cool. Yes.
And Lafayette in Hamilton.
Both fantastic parts, yes. Both quite similar in some ways, but yes, both very good. Definitely, I'd love to see a black Marius. Marius, are you listening? Thank you. There we go. Anyway, dream gender bend role. That's a role, obviously, that's traditionally female.
Catherine Pine 6.
Classic, yes. Well, I don't know if it's classic yet, but it's fantastic. I don't think we can still be going long enough to.
Many times. So I know exactly.
You're ready to do a Toby Marlowe and step in.
I am so ready to do it. And props to him for doing that, because I watched videos of him doing the Mega 6. He was so good.
He was fantastic.
But yeah, definitely Catherine Parris.
There we go. That's a different one. That's good. A lot of people just say Elphaba. I'm like, no, come on. Think outside the box. Everybody wants to be Elphaba. Yes, we all secretly, even I can't sing and I still want to try and do Elphaba. two questions to go. What's your favourite musical theatre song? That doesn't have to be one you've performed. It can be, but it doesn't have to be. That's the hardest question of the night.
I see why it's not so. Not so.
I see. Right, everybody says that during it. Everybody says that.
Why did you ask me that? I don't know.
We ask the same questions for everybody. If it's easier, you can change it to soundtrack.
I can't do that either. I don't know.
Catherine Parsong and Six. Is that a good one?
Oh, no, but I can't say Six. I can't say that. There's a reason why I can't say that yet. This is hard. Make them hear you from Ragtime.
Oh, that's a good one, yes. Ragtime's a kind of overlooked musical a bit, but it's very good, yes.
Oh, so it's not done very often. Amazing musical. When I did it in third year, I played Cole House. And my friend Jade, who asked the questions, she played Sarah. And it was just such an amazing show to be a part of, and such an amazing song to sing. And I shit you not, I cried every single time I sang Make Them Hear You. And it's one of those songs that has a message that is still, as I said, Marvin Gaye, it's still relevant to today. So yeah, definitely Make Them Hear You from Ragtime.
Last if question.
Not, One Day More from Les Mis.
Oh, that's a classic, isn't it? Yeah, I think everybody knows that, whether you know the musical or not, whether you've seen the musical, everybody knows One Day More.
Everyone.
Yes, it's definitely a classic. Last question. What is your top five shows in any order? And again, you don't have to have been in them.
I haven't got my phone with me. Fuck. Oh no.
Neil had one yet.
Hamilton.
Right, okay. Good, yeah. I say that as if it's a right answer. There's no right or wrong answer.
Memphis.
Oh yes.
I love Memphis. You're in
town. I love the Beverly Knight one's the only one I've seen, and it was fantastic.
You blew my mind.
Yes.
Beverly Knight is a force to be reckoned with.
Hamilton,
Memphis, 6. Ooh. Ragtime, that holds a special place in my heart. And
one more.
Do you know what? I really like Guys and Dolls.
Oh.
I really like Guys and Dolls.
That's an interesting one, yes. That's definitely. Well done, you managed it. You got 5 there. the last thing before you go, before we sign off, is have you heard of the Ice Bucket Challenge?
Yes, and if you're asking me to do it, I'm not doing it.
Well, that's fine. We're not asking you to do it. Really? I asked you if you know about it. Have you heard of it? Listen to what I ask, Alex. Yeah, have you heard of the Ice Bucket Challenge?
I've done it before.
Did I say you're going to be doing the Ice Bucket Challenge?
Listen, I have to be prepared for certain things.
You don't have to do that.
My mind runs away with me. I've got to make sure people know. No, but I've heard of it.
Yeah, that's fine. We're not going to ask you to do it. Don't worry. Well, the reason I bring that up is obviously when you did it years ago, whenever it was, 2012 or whatever, you had to do it and then nominate somebody to do the next one. So we've come up with the West End Talks nomination. So it's now your turn to inflict pain on somebody else. So you can nominate the minimum of one, but as many as you want. Anyone from film, TV, or theatre, front on stage or off stage, so like sound, lighting, or on stage, cast members, whoever it is, it's up to you. Preferably somebody you know, because the point is to get them in to do the chat. But who would you like to nominate?
Ellie Seaton.
Oh, that's a good one, yes. And just for people at home, how do we know Ellie?
I met her out of a pub. I'm outside a pub once.
No, not you. How do we know Ellie?
Oh! Oh, how do you...
That was nice to know that, but how would we know Ellie?
You would know her from the recent and amazing The Wedding Singer. She played... she was ensemble, but she also played Tina Turner in The Wedding Singer. Very recently. Oh, she's a force to be reckoned with. Like
the Wembley, the Troubadour.
Yeah, Wembley, yeah, the Troubadour.
Yes, I saw that. It was fantastic. That was one of the last things I saw before lockdown, actually.
Amazing show. And she will give you, she won't give you 10 out of 10, she'll give you 20. She's called Full Out Sue. Like, that's what she's known as. So, and she has the brightest personality. She's so lovely.
so genuine, so real, and just so happy. So I nominate Ellie Seaton.
So what we need to do now then, Alex, is once you finish the chat, go on to Twitter and put up on Twitter to say, just having a talk with West End Talks, Ellie, now it's your turn. And obviously tag us both in it so that we can get in touch with Ellie. But that's you. You have survived the chat. Thank you very much for joining us. All that's left, our pleasure. All that's left for you guys at home to remember is the charity. Where obviously me and Alex aren't just here for fun, although I'm hoping he did have fun. We're not just here for fun. We're here to support West End Talks. No, we're not here to support West End Talks. West End Talks are here to support acting for others, is what I meant to say there. This is why I don't get a script, because I'm rubbish at lines. This is why I'm not an actor. So Acting for Others is obviously the charity that we're supporting. Anything at all that you can give, pop it in the link in the bio below. They obviously help actors from all three sets, so film, TV and theatre. Not just at the moment, they help all year round, but obviously more so at the moment when theatres and everything is in darkness, when the arts are in darkness. So please give generously whatever you can. And join us next time when we will have Linda John-Pierre, who you'll know from Mamma Mia! The Party, or she was also EastEnders, and I think she won the Big Edition, but she certainly was on the Big Edition. Don't ask me if she won. Don't quote me if she won it, but we'll find that out and more when we join her next time. But Alex, thank you very much once again. It's been a genuine pleasure getting to know you, and take care.
Thank you so much for having me, guys.
Bye, guys. Thank you.